Neuromorphic computing. Technology race to bring faster, easier, cheaper, and smarter artificial intelligence by three ways. The first one is high performance computing, which is not an emerging technology. It is a mainstream technology, and it is already available today. The second one is quantum computing, which I talked about it in a previous video, and today I will talk about the third one, neuromorphic computing, the new entrant, which is going to revolutionize not only artificial intelligence, but also machine learning and deep learning. In the future, we will see a totally new chip inspired by a human brain. It will unlock new potentials, making the world smarter and more connected, and this will be the next generation of artificial intelligence. Now, with neuromorphic computing, many of what is considered impossible today will become possible, such as self-learning neuromorphic chips will transform education, facial recognition, manufacturing, healthcare, emergency services, smart cities, and defense. So, let us put together a brief description. Neuromorphic computing is trying to make our computers process more like our brains think. So, taking the actual operation of brains and putting that into silicon. But when will this technology be here? It is already here. Let me take you through more details from vision to reality. The inspiration for neuromorphic computing goes back all the way to the earliest days of computing itself. If you look at the early papers by Alan Turing, he actually talked about neurons, because back at his time, they had not invented the terminology of conventional computing, and the brain was the one example that he had. Neuromorphic computing is invented to work different from today's computers and similar to human brains, because human brains are completely different than transistors. Therefore, we have to not only redesign, but also to rethink everything we know about computer architecture. So, welcome to the world of neuromorphic computing. In the next few minutes, I will try to explain, in a simple and easy to understand way, the principles of neuromorphic computing, answering many questions, such as how computers are different than brains. What is the future of artificial intelligence with neuromorphic computing? How neuromorphic computing will change the world? What are the latest achievements in neuromorphic computing? So let us begin this journey together. We often talk about how traditional computing is reaching its limit. Let me explain that to you briefly. As of today, a single chip can contain billions of transistors, and each transistor is about 14 nanometers across. That is smaller than most of human viruses, but it is becoming more difficult to roll smaller transistors, which will need more explanation later. Hence, building an affordable and more powerful chips becomes difficult, and so traditional computing, as we know, reaching its limit. And because there is a threshold, we cannot move forward without making some seriously big changes to the way we structure computers. One of those exciting ways is quantum computing, and another way is neuromorphic computing, by making physical computers a little more like human brains. This kind of computing is called neuromorphic computing, which means designing and engineering computer chips to use the same physics of computation used by our own nervous system. This is different from an artificial neural network, which is a software run on a normal computer and mimics the logic of how a human brain thinks. Neuromorphic computing, the hardware version, and neural networks, the software version, can work together, because as we make progress in both fields, neuromorphic hardware will probably be the best option to run neural networks on. But for now, we are going to focus on neuromorphic computing and the really exciting achievements that have been made in this field in the last few years. At the very basic level, neuromorphic computing makes us throw out everything we think we know about computers, processors and computing in general, and looking at how our brains compute. It is a fact that today's computers execute very precisely defined instruction sets, but our brains are organic, intuitive, and fluid. Traditional microprocessors are synchronous, meaning every function and every instruction is governed by a clock. The clock, or specifically, the internal clock of the computer, says when instructions are executed and when functions happen. Everything works in harmony according to this clock. Our brains are different. They are asynchronous, meaning there is no internal clock to control our brain. Neurons operate with no prescribed order. We think, and then we just have thoughts. The thoughts build up on each other to build a different idea, or split into other different ideas. Just imagine the brainstorming of your mind. So, brains compute in very different ways. They compute in a structural, but also in a dynamic way. It is the interaction of these living organism cells, and so there is much more in the brains for what scientists are trying to harness and replicate to design similar types of neuromorphic chips. The brain operates at 20 watts, which it is about a light bulb. Actually, it is less than a light bulb, which power everything we do simultaneously, such as processing data streams and creatively thinking about new ideas and insights. That is all being done at 20 watts of power. So, neuromorphic computing work in a similar way. It is completely asynchronous, so functions and instructions happen in parallel when they happen. This means neuromorphic systems think more like brains do. They can adapt, recognize nuance, and teach themselves as they work. It is an elegant, organic, and beautiful way to think. In another perspective, traditional computers work in binary. Everything is either a 1 or 0, a yes or a no. You only have two options, so the code we use and the questions we ask. These kinds of computers must be structured in a very rigid way. Neuromorphic computing works in a little more flexible way. Instead of using an electric signal to mean 1 or 0, designers of these new chips want to make their computers' neurons talk to each other the way biological neurons do in our brains. To do this, you need a kind of precise electric current which flows across a synapse, or the space between neurons. Depending on the number and kind of ion, the receiving computer neuron is activated in some way and giving you a lot more computational options than just your basic yes and no. This ability to transmit a gradient of understanding from neuron to neuron, and to have them all working together simultaneously, means that neuromorphic chips could eventually be more energy efficient than our normal computers, especially for really complicated tasks. To realize this exciting potential of neuromorphic computing, we need new materials, because what we are using in our computers today is not going to make it. The physical properties of something like silicon, as an example, make it hard to control the current between artificial neurons. So a new design from an MIT team uses different materials. These materials are single crystalline silicon and silicon germanium, layered on top of one another. But another team in Korea is investigating other materials. They used tantalum oxide to give them precise control over the flow of ions, and it is even more durable. However, another team in Colorado, in the United States of America, is implementing magnets to precisely control the way of the computer neurons communicate. These advances in the actual architecture of neuromorphic systems are all working toward getting us to a place where the neurons on these chips can learn as they compute. Actually, software neural networks have been able to do this for a while. But this is a new advancement for physical neuromorphic devices, and these experiments are showing promising results. So, neuromorphic computing will solve problems that involve interacting with real-world data in real time, such as robotics which are moving around through places, or drones which are flying around among the buildings in the city and responding to external events, especially when and where there is unexpected adaptation by these robotics or drones, which is required instantly and intelligently. Scientists think that near-term applications, what you will see in 4 or 5 year time frame, you will start to see neuromorphic chips in smart factories where we have already robotic deployments. So, we may be able to apply neuromorphic intelligence to make these robots assemble in a smarter way. So, to make the world smarter and more connected, neuromorphic computing is inspiring the scientists to figure out how brains have evolved over a billion years, and taking that evolution and putting it in neuromorphic chips. Now, did I say before in this video that the neuromorphic computing technology is already here? Yes, because a team of researchers in the University of Manchester in United Kingdom has invented a neuromorphic system which is called spiking neural network architecture. The Manchester team uses the traditional digital parts like cores and routers, connecting and communicating with each other in innovative ways. These researchers have successfully demonstrated that they can use their system to simulate the behavior of the human cortex. The hope is that a computer that behaves like a brain will give us enough computing power to simulate something as complicated as the brain itself. This will help us to understand diseases like Alzheimer's. Now, the news is that the spiking neural network architecture has now matched the results we would get from a traditional supercomputer using high-performance computing technology. This is huge because neural networks offer the possibility of higher speed and more complexity for less energy, space, and cost. And with this new finding, we see that they are edging closer to the best performance we have been able to achieve so far. Overall, scientists are working toward having a better understanding of how the brain works in the first place, but they are also improving the artificial materials we use to mimic biological systems and creating hardware architectures that work with and optimize neuromorphic algorithms accordingly. Changing computer hardware to behave more like the human brain is one of a few options we have for continuing to improve computer performance and to get computers to learn and adapt the way humans do. Okay, I hope you have been inspired. If you did not already know, you may now understand how neuromorphic computing works and what the potentials are. If you find it helpful, feel free to like, share, ask, comment, and most importantly, subscribe. Thank you very much for your time and for watching.